Harper Audio presents Competing Against Luck, the story of innovation and customer choice by Clayton M. Christensen, Taddy Hall, Karen Dillon, and David S. Duncan. Read by John Pruden. This digital audiobook includes an enhancement PDF containing each section's chapter takeaways, questions for leaders, and notes for reference. When you hear me refer to a note in the text, its associated citation will be available to read on the PDF. You may retrieve this PDF from the same site that you downloaded this digital audiobook from and keep it available for reference while listening to this program. Introduction. Why you should hire this book. This is a book about progress. Yes, it's a book about innovation and how to get better at it. But at its core, this book is about the struggles we all face to make progress in our lives. If you're like many entrepreneurs and managers, the word progress might not spring to mind when you're trying to innovate. Instead, you obsess about creating the perfect product with just the right combination of features and benefits to appeal to customers. Or you try to continually fine-tune your existing products so they're more profitable or differentiated from your competitors. You think you know what your customers would like, but in reality, it can feel pretty hit or miss. Place enough bets and, with a bit of luck, something will work out. But that doesn't have to be the case, not when you truly understand what causes consumers to make the choices they do. Innovation can be far more predictable and far more profitable, but only if you think about it differently. It's about progress, not products. So if you are tired of throwing yourself and your organization into well-intended innovation efforts that routinely underwhelm, if you want to create products and services that you know in advance customers will not only be eager to buy, but willing to pay a premium price for, if you want to compete and win against those relying on luck to successfully innovate, then listen on. This book is about helping you make progress too. Getting better and better at the wrong things. For as long as I can remember, innovation has been a top priority and a top frustration for companies around the world. In a recent McKinsey poll, 84% of global executives acknowledged that innovation is extremely important to their growth strategies, yet a staggering 94% were unsatisfied with their own innovation performance. Most people would agree that the vast majority of innovations fall far short of ambitions, a fact that has remained unchanged for decades. On paper, this makes no sense. Companies have never had more sophisticated tools and techniques at their disposal, and there are more resources than ever deployed in reaching innovation goals. In 2015, according to an article in Strategy and Business, Note 1, 1,000 publicly held companies spent $680 billion on research and development alone, a 5.1% increase over the previous year. And businesses have never known more about their customers. The big data revolution has greatly increased the variety, volume, and velocity of data collection, along with the sophistication of the analytical tools applied to it. Hopes for this data trove are higher than ever. Correlation is enough, Note 2, then Wired editor-in-chief Chris Anderson famously declared in 2008. We can, he implied, solve innovation problems by the sheer brute force of the data deluge. Ever since Michael Lewis chronicled the Oakland A's unlikely success in Moneyball, who knew on-base percentage was a better indicator of offensive success than batting averages, organizations have been trying to find the Moneyball equivalent of customer data that would lead to innovation success. Yet few have. Innovation processes in many companies are structured and disciplined, and the talent applying them is highly skilled. There are careful stage gates, rapid iterations, and checks and balances built into most organizations' innovation processes. Risks are carefully calculated and mitigated. Principles like Six Sigma have pervaded innovation process design, so we now have precise measurements and strict requirements for new products to meet at each stage of their development. From the outside, it looks like companies have mastered an awfully precise scientific process. But for most of them, innovation is still painfully hit or miss. And worst of all this activity gives the illusion of progress without actually causing it. Companies are spending exponentially more to achieve only modest incremental innovations while completely missing the mark on the breakthrough innovations critical to long-term sustainable growth. As Yogi Berra famously observed, "We're lost, but we're making good time." What's gone so wrong? Here is the fundamental problem. The masses and masses of data that companies accumulate are not organized in a way that enables them to reliably predict which ideas will succeed. Instead, the data is along the lines of, this customer looks like that one, this product has similar performance attributes as that one, and these people behaved the same way in the past, or 68% of customers say they prefer version A over version B. None of that data, however, actually tells you why customers make the choices that they do. Let me illustrate. Here I am, Clayton Christensen. I'm 64 years old. I'm 6 feet 8 inches tall. My shoe size is 16. My wife and I have sent all our children off to college. I live in a suburb of Boston and drive a Honda minivan to work. I have a lot of other characteristics and attributes, but these characteristics have not yet caused me to go out and buy the New York Times today. There might be a correlation between some of these characteristics and the propensity of customers to purchase the Times, but those attributes don't cause me to buy that paper or any other product. If a company doesn't understand why I might choose to hire its product in certain circumstances and why I might choose something else in others, its data, note 3, about me or people like me, note 4, is unlikely to help it create any new innovations for me. It's seductive to believe that we can see important patterns and cross-references in our data sets, but that doesn't mean one thing actually caused the other. As Nate Silver, author of The Signal and the Noise, Why So Many Predictions Fail But Some Don't, points out, ice cream sales and forest fires are correlated because both occur more often in the summer heat. But there is no causation. You don't light a patch of the Montana brush on fire when you buy a pint of Häagen-Dazs. Of course, it's no surprise that correlation isn't the same as causality. But although most organizations know that, I don't think they act as if there is a difference. They're comfortable with correlation. It allows managers to sleep at night. But correlation does not reveal the one thing that matters most in innovation, the causality behind why I might purchase a particular solution. Yet few innovators frame their primary challenge around the discovery of a cause. Instead, they focus on how they can make their products better, more profitable, or differentiated from the competition. As W. Edwards Deming, the father of the quality movement that transformed manufacturing, once said, "If you do not know how to ask the right question, you discover nothing." After decades of watching great companies fail over and over again, I've come to the conclusion that there is indeed a better question to ask. What job did you hire that product to do? For me, this is a neat idea. When we buy a product, we essentially hire something to get a job done. If it does the job well, when we are confronted with the same job, we hire that same product again. And if the product does a crummy job, we fire it and look around for something else we might hire to solve the problem. Every day, stuff happens to us. Jobs arise in our lives that we need to get done. Some jobs are little, pass the time while waiting in line. Some are big, find a more fulfilling career. Some surface unpredictably, dress for an out-of-town business meeting after the airline lost my suitcase. Some regularly, pack a healthy, tasty lunch for my daughter to take to school. Other times, we know they're coming, When we realize we have a job to do, we reach out and pull something into our lives to get the job done. I might, for example, choose to buy the New York Times because I have a job to fill my time while waiting for a doctor's appointment, and I don't want to read the boring magazines available in the lobby. Or perhaps because I'm a basketball fan and it's March Madness time. It's only when a job arises in my life that the Times can solve for me that I'll choose to hire the paper to do it. Or perhaps I have it delivered to my door so that my neighbors think I'm informed, and nothing about their zip code or median household income will tell the Times that either. This core insight emerged in the course I teach at Harvard Business School, but has subsequently been refined and shaped over the past 2 decades by numerous conversations with my co-authors, trusted colleagues, collaborators, and thought leaders. It's been validated and proven in the work of some of the world's most respected business leaders and innovators, Amazon's Jeff Bezos and Intuit's Scott Cook, for example, as well as in the founding of highly successful entrepreneurial ventures in recent years. Who would have imagined that a service that makes travelers pay to stay in a stranger's spare bedroom would be valued at more than Marriott, Starwood, or Wyndham worldwide? Airbnb did it. The videos that Sal Khan made to teach math to his young cousin were, by his description, cheaper and crappier than many other educational videos already online, but they now enable millions of students all over the world to learn at their own pace. These innovations were aimed at jumping on the latest trends or rolling out another new flavor to boost sales. They weren't created to add more bells and whistles to an existing product so the company could charge customers more. They were conceived, developed, and launched into the market with a clear understanding of how these products would help consumers make the progress they were struggling to achieve. When you have a job to be done and there isn't a good solution, cheaper and crappier is better than nothing. Imagine the potential of something truly great. This book is not focused on celebrating past innovation successes, however. It's about something much more important to you: creating and predicting new ones. The foundation of our thinking is the theory of jobs to be done, which focuses on deeply understanding your customers' struggle for progress and then creating the right solution and attendant set of experiences to ensure you solve your customers' jobs well every time. Theory may conjure up images of ivory tower musings, but I assure you that it is the most practical and useful business tool we can offer you. Good theory helps us understand how and why. It helps us make sense of how the world works and predict the consequences of our decisions and our actions. Jobs theory, note 5, we believe, can move companies beyond hoping that correlation is enough to the causal mechanism of successful innovation. Innovation may never be a perfect science, but that's not the point. We have the ability to make innovation a reliable engine for growth, an engine based on a clear understanding of causality, rather than simply casting seeds in the hopes of one day harvesting some fruit. The theory of jobs to be done is the product of some very real-world insights and experiences. I've asked my co-authors to work with me on this book in part because they've been using jobs theory in their everyday work for years, and have much experience bringing the theory into the practical realm of innovation. Together, we have shaped, refined, and polished the theory, along with the thoughts and contributions of many trusted colleagues and business leaders whose work and insights we'll feature throughout this book. My co-author Taddy Hall was in my first class at Harvard Business School, and he and I have collaborated on projects throughout the years, including co-authoring with Intuit founder Scott Cook the Harvard Business Review HBR article, Marketing Malpractice, that first debuted the jobs to be done theory in the pages of HBR. He's currently a principal at the Cambridge Group, part of the Nielsen Company, and leader of the Nielsen Breakthrough Innovation Project. As such, he has worked closely with some of the world's leading companies, including many of those mentioned throughout this book. More important, he's used jobs theory in his innovation advisory work for years. Karen Dillon is the former editor of Harvard Business Review and my co-author on How Will You Measure Your Life? You'll see her perspective as a longtime senior manager in media organizations struggling to get innovation right reflected throughout this book. Throughout our collaboration, she has seen her role as that of a proxy for you, the listener. She is also one of my most trusted allies in helping bridge the worlds of academia and practitioners. David Duncan is a senior partner at InnoSight, a consulting firm I co-founded in 2000. He's a leading thinker and advisor to senior executives on innovation strategy and growth, helping them to navigate disruptive change, create sustainable growth, and transform their organizations to thrive for the long term. The clients he's worked with tell me they've completely changed the way they think about their business and transformed their culture to be truly focused on customer jobs. One client even named a conference room after him. Over the past decade, his work in helping to develop and implement jobs theory has made him one of its most knowledgeable and innovative practitioners. Throughout the book, we've chosen primarily to use the first person I, simply to make it more accessible for listeners. But we have written this book as true partners. It's very much the product of a collaborative we and our collective expertise. Finally, a quick roadmap of the book. Section 1 provides an introduction.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.